Doesn't us being here now mean it never happened?
So after doing my first explained video for Tenet with an analysis of the plot and ending, I thought it would be a good idea to follow up that video by looking at some of the other talking points and questions which I didn't originally cover. These were questions that you guys raised and also ones which were put forward by a subscriber named Jay, who suggested some great talking points to tackle. In particular, I'm going to be explaining how time inversion works with certain plot points in Christopher Nolan's Tenet. This analysis will contain spoilers, so if you do happen to be someone who hasn't seen the film, then I would recommend watching this video after you've seen it. If you want to see more on the film in the future, alongside other movie releases in the coming year, then don't forget to subscribe to the channel and turn on your notifications. Also, if you enjoy this video, remember to give it a like rating. Without further ado, let's dive into the use of time inversion in the plot and storytelling of Christopher Nolan's Tenet. Now, in my original explained video, which was focused on the overall plot of Tenet, I discussed that I wasn't necessarily going to tackle the quantum and theoretical science, because I believe that the plot uses a combination of real science, but also many original ideas, which for some people can become overwhelming when comprehending what happens in the film in a straightforward way. However, when it comes to focusing on what's happened in specific moments and clarifying certain complications that viewers had, I think it is interesting to explore how time travel and more specifically inversion works from a plot and storytelling perspective. There are a few scientific concepts that need to be brought up when discussing these elements, but they will be ones that are prominent in the film. When looking at certain scenes in Tenet, we want to grasp the bigger picture so that we can truly understand how everything fits together and ultimately impacts us through character and story. On rewatch, the smaller details become evident and the whole experience is heightened because of this. The first question that I want to tackle involves whether Tenet has both time travel and inversion, alongside how it's accomplished. This is a question that some viewers have raised after watching the film once, and it's key to be able to address the later points. Well, rather than the relatively more straightforward idea of time travel seen in similar movies, where the characters actually jump backwards or forwards through time to fixed points and the audience follows them on that journey, Tenet uses time reversal, or what we know as time inversion. This is a rather different approach and an important distinction, because time travel still adheres to the general rules of physics, at least insofar as there remains a cause and effect to every action. Time inversion, however, as the name of the film makes clear, inverts or reverses this with events, motions, and people moving backwards rather than forwards. There is still cause and effect, but Tenet protects the threat of paradox by having cause and effect permanent. What happens has happened, to borrow from the film's dialogue. The palindrome name Tenet also tells audiences that what's being used here is the idea of a time reversal invariance, which is where events can play out the same way forwards or backwards, and it can be difficult to tell which one you're watching. The question of how time is progressing and which order events are happening and have happened is a huge part of the film's storytelling approach, as Nolan plays with what the hero and audience's positions relative to the story really mean. In terms of how inversion is accomplished, well, that is down to the turnstile machine seen throughout the film. During the gun sequence with Clemence Posier's character, we learn more about how inversion works and where it comes from. This all ties into how Washington and his team, including Pattinson, use the technology to travel backwards through time to prevent the reversal of the world's entropy. We see these turnstile machines in the film at the Freeport sequence, the Red Room Blue Room scene, the reversing boat, and in the final battle on Stalsk 12. In terms of how these inverted chambers came from the future and arrived at the past, we learn that at some point in Tenet's future, a scientist discovered a means of inverting the entropy of objects using nuclear fission. This technology was used to create a machine called a turnstile, which inverts the entropy of everything or anyone placed inside it. That person or object then begins to move backwards through time instead of forwards. By inverting objects using the turnstiles, people in the future can start a war on the past, for example by burying inverted time capsules that send gold and instructions to Andre Sator. Because they are working with the benefit of hindsight, the people of the future have a major tactical advantage over the present day. However, time inversion also has its weaknesses, especially when what you're inverting is not an object but a human being. A person who has gone through a turnstile is effectively swimming upstream. They might be moving backwards, but everything else is still moving forwards, making the world a confusing and dangerous place for them to navigate in. Even the air is unbreathable because it cannot pass through the membrane of their inverted lungs, and the only way they could breathe normal air would be to suck oxygen out of their blood and back into their lungs to reform an unfiltered air and then be exhaled. This is why inverted characters in certain scenes, such as the protagonist and Sator during the reversed car chase sequence, wear the breathing masks that they do. The heat transfer of fire and ice is also inverted, which is why the protagonist being engulfed in flames during this scene causes him to suffer hypothermia instead of burns. The turnstiles that cause the moments of inversion in Tenet are also based on a hypothesis in theoretical physics that was proposed by Richard Feynman and John Wheeler. To recap a little, an electron is a particle that holds a negative charge, and a positron is its antimatter counterpart, a particle with the same mass as an electron that holds an equal but opposite positive charge. Electrons and positrons are mirror images of each other, and it's traditionally understood that they're two different types of subatomic particle. However, Feynman and Wheeler theorize that what we perceive as positrons are actually just electrons that have reached a point in time where they turned around and are now coming back the other way with their charge inverted. This could explain why electrons and positrons have the exact same mass, which is why they are essentially the same object. But applying this inversion to some scenes, like one of the final ones with Kat and Sator on the yacht, we can clear up some confusion. Many people have asked me in the comments of other Tenet videos why Kat was not seen in reverse and not wearing a breathing mask at the end of the film. Well, on rewatch, you start to see that in the case of this scene, certain characters in certain moments of the film are not inverted. Kat had inverted back to that point in time with the protagonist, Neil, Ives, and the future soldiers on the boat before going onto the yacht where she eventually kills Sator. The Kat and Sator we see on the yacht are both the future versions of themselves at this particular moment in time, with Sator not realizing that this is the same Kat who he shot with an inverted bullet earlier on in the film. As future Kat dives off the boat after killing Sator, the present Kat and her son, in that particular timeline, see a woman jump off, not knowing at the time that it's actually a Kat from a near future scenario. One of the many dangers of inverting that we learn in the film is the risk of accidentally encountering your past self. This is a common feature of time travel movies, and characters are typically warned against it because they could end up changing the future. In Tenet, however, the danger comes down to a single word, annihilation. In physics, annihilation refers to a reaction where a particle, like an electron, collides with its antiparticle, a positron. When this happens, both the particle and its antiparticle disappear and energy is released. Therefore, an inverted person interacting with their past self could cause both versions of that person to be annihilated. This is why Tenet's inverted agents have to wear protective gear. This principle of annihilation is also what makes the algorithm the ultimate doomsday weapon. The current state of affairs in Tenet is that the vast majority of the world is experiencing time as normal, and only a few objects and people in it are inverted. As long as those inverted objects and people don't interact with the forward-moving versions of themselves, they are safe. However, the algorithm would invert the entropy of the entire world. Every particle would be converted into its antiparticle and start to move backwards in time. The moment that happened, those particles and antiparticles would collide, resulting in total annihilation. Not only would everything in the world cease to exist, the ripple effect through time would mean that it never existed in the first place. This, of course, leads to the grandfather paradox. The grandfather paradox is one of the most famous logical problems associated with time travel, and it boils down to this. Is it possible to go back into the past and kill your own grandfather? It creates a paradox which Neil claims that future descendants may know how to execute. However, Neil's mantra at the end of the film of what's happened, happened is a concluding expression of faith and another answer to the grandfather paradox. This in turn means that the existence of a grandfather in the first place means the plan to kill the grandfather must have somehow failed. Sure enough, Neil and the protagonist end up successfully averting the future antagonist's plan to kill their ancestors. Tenet's concept of a time war also means introducing battle tactics unique to fighting across time as well as space, and one tactic that's used several times is the temporal pincer movement. In a traditional pincer movement, an army is split in order to attack an enemy on multiple fronts. The goal is to envelop the enemy, putting them in a vulnerable position with no way to retreat. A temporal pincer movement also attacks on two fronts, but in time rather than space. One team experiences the battle in normal time, reporting everything that happens to a second team that's on standby. The second team then inverts via a turnstile and attacks from the opposite direction with the benefit of the first team's knowledge. Sator uses a temporal pincer movement during the Talin heist, which is why the protagonist's attempt to trick him with an empty case fails. The Sator that he sees holding Kat hostage in the car is inverted, while the forward-moving Sator is waiting by the turnstile with a radio, listening to reports about everything happening on the highway. That's why Sator counts down or counts up from his perspective, using his fingers rather than by speaking. Anything he said would come out backwards. When the protagonist throws the case over, Sator already knows that it's empty. Tenet's soldiers use another temporal pincer movement in their assault on Stalsk 12 at the end of the movie. They are divided into two teams, red team who are moving forwards and blue team who are inverted. The entire battle takes place across the span of 10 minutes and both teams have the benefit of the other team's knowledge of what happens. This is how, for example, they are able to synchronize the destruction of a building precisely halfway through the fight. The effectiveness of Tenet's temporal pincer movement is neutralized by the fact that Sator's men also have access to a turnstile, and therefore have both normal and inverted soldiers in the field. However, Tenet's goal isn't actually to win the fight, but to make it look like they've failed, while Ives and the protagonist use the battle as cover to secretly remove the algorithm from its tomb before it's buried by the explosion. Sator will die thinking he's won, but the future antagonists won't get their hands on the algorithm. After the battle, as Neil decides to invert again so that he can go back, unlock the gates for the protagonist, and sacrifice his life to save him, he reveals that he's actually known the protagonist for years. The protagonist created Tenet in the future, recruited Neil, and set up what is actually a far greater temporal pincer movement designed to stop the algorithm from going off. As Neil explains, the end of Tenet isn't actually the end of the war, but the middle of it. With the crucial battle won, the protagonist now has to use his knowledge of how things played out to set in motion all the things that enabled them to win. From founding Tenet to sending Neil back to help his past self. But that was my video explaining some of the main questions surrounding how time inversion works in the plot of Christopher Nolan's Tenet. I hope this did help some of you guys understand some of the more difficult events and narrative beats a bit better, and I'm looking forward to hearing what else you picked out. So don't forget to let me know down below in the comments section. You can also check out my full series of Tenet videos, including my original explained upload, in a playlist on my channel if you haven't seen them already. But for more content on films like Tenet, then don't forget to subscribe to the channel and turn on your notifications. Also, if you enjoyed this video, remember to leave a like rating. I will be coming back to uploading videos on Tenet later on this year, but for now, I will be mainly focusing on other films that are releasing soon and also beginning my Road to Dune series in the coming weeks. Let me know what other types of films you want to see covered on the channel, as I will be considering what you suggest. But anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed it. I've been Cortex, and as always, make some noise.